bojte se ništa, samo polako, polako. Neka prvo idu žene i djeca. Doće 30 autobusa, prebacit ćemo vas prema kladnju. Odatle ćete preći na teritoriju koju kontrolišu, ali ne snage. Samo bez panike i propustite malu djecu i žene. Nemojte da se neko djete izgubi. Ne bojte se ništa, niko vam neće ništa uraditi.
Independent television in Belgrade. What's going on today here?
Do you know what's going on?
Evo nas, 11. jula 1995. godine u srpskoj Srebrenici. Uoči još jednog velikog praznika srpskoga, poklanjamo srpskom narodu ovaj grad i napokon došao je trenutak da se posle bune protiv Dahija Turcima osvetimo na ovom prostoru.
Idemo do kraja da oslobodimo teritoriju opštine Srebrenica. Civilnom stanovništvu garantujemo sigurnost. Biće bezbedno preveženi tamo gdje oni to žele. Mi se nismo uplašili djeca avijacije, idemo do kraja.
Je vous demande si vous plaidez coupable ou si vous plaidez non coupable.
Nisam kriv.
This is a case about the triumph of evil. A story about how officers and soldiers of the Bosnian Serb Army, men who professed to be professional soldiers, men who professed to represent the ideals of a distinguished and Serbian past, organized, planned, and willingly participated in genocide, the only way to attempt to eradicate this stain and to deliver justice to the victims of this tragedy is to expose the individual criminal responsibility of those persons who perpetrated and assisted in the commission of these heinous crimes. The prosecutor in this trial will prove the criminal responsibility of one of those individuals, General Radislav Krstic.
Ja sam general potpukovnik Radislav Krstic, komandant 5. korpusa Vojske Republike Srpske. Rođen sam 15.2.1948. godine u Vlasenici, Bosna i Hercegovina. Prije hapšenja na službi sam bio u Sokocu, a porodica mi živi u Beogradu.
We have charged General Krstić with 8 counts. One count of genocide. One count of the complicity to commit genocide. 5 counts of crimes against humanity. And one count of a violation of the laws and customs of war. All of the acts described in the indictment occurred within the Drina Corps area of responsibility, the area that was under the command of General Krstić. And all of these acts relate to the events that occurred during and after the fall of the UN safe area of Srebrenica, acts which resulted in the ethnic cleansing of the Bosnian Muslims from the Srebrenica enclave.
U ovom postupku odbrana će dokazati da general Krstić nije naredio, učestvovao, niti na bilo koji način doprineo svemu onome što se desilo u Glogovi, Cerskoj, Orahovcu, Pilici, Petkovcima, Kozluku i svim drugim mestima opisanim u optužnici. Dokazat ćemo da je postojao jedan drugi paralelni lanac komandovanja koji je bio daleko od očiju, znanja i svake mogućnosti da general Krstić utiče na njega.
The counts of the indictment can be divided into two broad categories. The first category is the deportation and forcible transfer of an estimated 20 to 30,000 Muslims from the Srebrenica enclave by members of the VRS on the 12th and the 13th of July, 1995. The second broad category is the systematic, organized mass murder of thousands of Muslim civilians and soldiers who had laid down their arms by members of the VRS. Most, but not all, of these executions occurred between the 11th and the 17th of July, 1995. Now, we're also going to present video footage for your honors that was taken on the 11th of July, showing General Mladic, General Jovanovic, General Krstic triumphantly entering the deserted town of Srebrenica.
The attack on Srebrenica began on the 6th of July 1995. General Ratko Mladic, accompanied by the soldiers of the VRS General Staff and Drina Corps, entered the deserted town on the 11th of July. Serbian TV cameras followed his every step, and Mladic acted, as described by a witness testifying before the tribunal, as the lead actor, show host and director. Some of the footage has helped the Office of the Prosecutor reconstruct the events in Srebrenica on the 11th and 12th of July in 1995. The footage includes tapes of the two meetings in the Fontana Hotel in Bratunac. The copies reached the OTP through unidentified channels. At Mladic's request, Ton Karamans, commander of the Dutch battalion, brought Nasib Manzic to the first meeting, held on the night of the 11th of July. Manzic was a high school teacher from Srebrenica and acted as the unwilling representative of the refugees who'd sought protection in the UN base in Potočari.
Trebam da dobijem jasan stav, predstavnika vašeg naroda. Da li želite da opstanem, ostanete ili nestanete. I spreman sam sutra primiti delegaciju odgovornih ljudi muslimanske strane u 10 sati na ovome mjestu. Neće be i u vašim rukama sudbina vašeg naroda. Ne samo na ovom prostoru. Završit se.
The next day, Colonel Karamans brought two more representatives of the Srebrenica civilians to the second meeting in Bratunac, Cemilo Omanovic and Ibro Nohanovic. On that occasion, General Radislav Krstic, the then Drina Corps Chief of Staff, sat next to Mladic. General Mladic again dominated the meeting. Soon after the meeting ended, several dozens of buses and trucks arrived at Potočari and the deportations of women and children began. Cemilo Omanovic and her family spent the night between the 12th and 13th of July in Potočari, waiting for their turn to come.
Ta druga noć je još bila strašnija od prve. Ja mislim da sam imala najstrašniju noć u svom životu. Predveće i te noći cijeli su srpski vojnici i srpski narod išao na kamionima, pucao, vrištao, cičao, išli su prema Srebrenici, vraćali se. Između nas su dolazili srpski vojnici uperenih baterija. Vodili su jednog po jednog čovjeka napolje, opet po drugog, tako i iz autobusa su se čuli krici. Žena se porađala, vrištala, nije imao da joj pomogne. Druga je u autobusu poludila, vrisak, cika. To se sve nekako prenosi na narod i onda svi odjednom iz sebe neki krik izbaci. To je bilo strahota. I onda pođemo kao talas jedni preko drugih, onda se umirimo i sve tako. Bacali su nešto preko, kao pijesak, pa su onda ljudi kašljali, kihali. Kažu da su to bili oni zagušljivci, otrovi. Mi smo stavili plahte od djece preko lica, a bebu smo stavili u kolica i prekrili je pelenom da ne bi se zatrovala. Ljudi su povraćali, kašljali. Žena tamo ludi. Ovamo, sad kad je bio mjesečna noć, tiha, no, već od umora svijet počinje da utanja usan, da zaspobi. Odjednom iz obližnje klaonice dopire glas muškarca koji je ličio na glas Hođić Fikrata, koga smo mi poznali. Ono s tugom kao da ga muče, da mu kožu deru, govori nesi be, hedi be. Pa onda se sruče hiljade vlanaca niz njega. I onda narod ustaje i krene jedni preko drugih, gazimo i opet se to povuče i opet prekinuje se sve kod tiho, taman ono da se smiriš, ponovo nešto ti se desi, opet izvuci mučenog čovjeka. I tako je bila ta noć strave i užasa.
The officers and soldiers of the UN Dutch battalion claimed before the tribunal that they had not been able to offer any resistance to the far superior force that attacked the safe haven. As they advanced towards Srebrenica, the Serb forces captured some 50 blue helmets manning the UN checkpoints and threatened to kill them if NATO launched airstrikes. The nature of the UN mission changed.
Were you armed?
Yes, I was.
In what position was your weapon?
I had to hold it on my back.
Why did you have to put your weapon on your back?
Our orders were not to be aggressive to the Serb soldiers.
We put all the weapons we had, small caliber weapons, inside one APC, and we lifted the .50 caliber machine guns from the APCs towards the skies, and we saw the Serb forces coming towards our location on the road. And another group of Serb soldiers through the fields.
After that, an order came from the UN headquarters for the Blue Helmets to assist with the evacuation of refugees. The Dutch roped off the area, steering the people towards the buses. It looked, a Dutch serviceman described, as if the Blue Helmets were evacuating the refugees while the Serb soldiers sat and smoked by the roadside, unconcerned.
Taj četvrtak crni kad je osvanuo, bilo ujutru ranije, malo mi je to dijete spavalo. Probudila sam ga, hajde sine da idemo, evo sad će na kamione da idemo, tu na traki da prođemo. Prešli smo tamo bliže da bi bili traki. To je tu čitav svijet, ne možeš tako brzo prijeći. Vidim, njemu nije dobro. Tražila sam vodi, nema vodi. Bio je s nama neki naš prijatelj, stariji čovjek. On je rekao da će otići da donese vodi. Nije ga duže bilo, donio je vodi. Kad je došao sa te vode, bio je bijel kao zid. Tu mu je bila žena. Kimao je glavom. Moja draga, kad ti živ dođo, šta sam sve vidio. Kimao je glavom, počele su suze. Sve sam vidio, baška glave, baška trupine. Toliko toga ima, gdje sam išao na vodu. To moje dijete opet počelo da se gubi, drhtati, tako da bi pao. Ja sam ga opet malo rasladila. Došao je red da idemo na tu traku. Na toj traci su nas propustili. Ja sam pomisla, hvala ti Bože, prošli smo. Međutim, smo naišli odmah na njihov red vojnika i lijevo i desno, a mi smo sad išli između njih, to je kao hodnik. Oni su nam sa strane kao zidovi, a mi smo između njih išli kao kroz hodnik. Bili smo u pola tog puta, čujem glas Popoviću, pazi ovoga. Pomislila sam da je to odmah na moje dijete. Opet sam našla snage da mu prešapćem, ne skiraj ti se sine ti, samo hajde. Išli smo dole još 50 možda metara, istog reda lijevo, iskočio je taj njihov vojnik. Rekao je mom djetu, tu vi na desno, a ti mladiću lijevo. On je rekao, bo što ja sam 81. godište. On je opet ponovio, vi desno, imao je neke torbe u rukama, baci torbu desno, a ti lijevo. Ja sam ga tako zgrabila i ja sam ponavljala za njim. On je opet vikao, ja sam 81. godište, što ja, šta ćete od mene? I ja sam ponavljala za njim, nemojte bogati, pa on je 81. godište, što, šta će vam on? On je opet ponovio, ja sam ga držala čvrsto uza se. On je ga zgrabio, zgrabio onu torbu, on je bacio desno. Njega je zgrabio iz moju ruku, odbacio lijevo. On je se okrenuo, kaže samo meni, uzmi ti meni mama, torbu uzmi.
As the refugees fled toward the buses, Muslim men and boys were separated from their families and detained in Potocari. The process of collecting the victims had begun. Those who had been separated were robbed, some were beaten, some were summarily executed in Potocari. While these events were occurring, members of the main staff and the Drina Corps were present in Potocari. Now, following their separation from their families, the men and the boys were forced onto buses and they were driven from the enclave to distant locations that their captors did not want the world to see.
Ajde redom tamo za njim.
Ne, vi lijevo. Ajmo kolone, ja po jedan, nemoj budemo tako, lijevo tu.
Thereafter, the women and the children and some men were put on buses and they were deported from the enclave and taken to a location near the front line known as Luque. At that location, there was another separation process, and the men were separated. And then the women and children were permitted to cross the no man's land into the free territory. The men and the boys who had been separated in Potocari and the men and the boys who had been separated at Tisza were later executed.
Gospođo, ja imam jedno kratko pitanje. Imate li vi nešto što biste htjeli sada kazati, a što vam još nitko nije postavio kao pitanje?
Da, ne može.
Vi?
Da, da, postavite pitanje, gospođo.
Molila bi vas da pitate gospodina Krstića, ako može, da li nema nade da ne postoji negdje neko, bar to moje dijete koje su mi iz ruku uzeli živ. Jer ga sanjam, kaže, ovako mi nosi cvijeće, kaže, majka, evo ja sam došao. Ja ga grabim, pitam, gdje si sine bio? Bio sam, majka, u Vlasanci, sve do sad sam bio u Vlasanci. Pa bi molila ako bi gospodin Krstić znao to nešto, da bi bio negdje živ.
Now, Mr. President and your honors, I'd like to turn my attention to another subject, and that is the killings. Our evidence will show that a minimum number of 7,574 persons from Srebrenica are missing and presumed dead as a result of the events that I've been describing. Now, Mr. President and your honors, not all of the Muslims who had fled in the direction of Potocari. Approximately 15,000 Muslims, mostly males, of military age, went to the northern part of the enclave, to an area around Susanjari in Jaglici. There were approximately 15,000 men and boys in that group of people. Approximately a third of that group was armed with small arms. The remaining members of that group were unarmed and were civilians. On the evening of the 11th of July, these people who were in the Susanjari area formed a large column and attempted to break out of the enclave and proceed north to the area ultimately of Tuzla. These people in this column were quickly detected, and they were attacked by the Bosnian Serb Army. And the Bosnian Serb Army set up along this road that I'm indicating that runs from Bratunac through Konjevic Polje and Nova Kasaba, set up a steel curtain that interdicted this column.
Ispod tebe, molim te, još poguraj naprijed, panika im je da ih istisnemo.
Ja se spuštam od onog mjesta gdje sam bio dole na onu stranicu koju je rentirao.
Je li ono tvrdo?
A da, tu na to tvrdo, ne zna da je vidim ko na zvonu.
To, brate, ja vidim to tvrdo, ja sam ispred tebe, ajmo da ih opletemo, frkaj im je sad, pritisni, hoću urlanja da čujem, juriš. Ajde, brate, sad pritisni, frkaj im je sad, pritisni, na to pak da ne može ništa.
Radi, ja sam davno na tvrdome, samo što oni lijevo od mene, oni su nešto stali, ne znam šta
je. Oni kaže, čekaju tebe, zauzmi najbolje položaj, opleti dole da čujem vukove kako zavijaju, ajde!
Only a small portion of the column was able to succeed in breaking through that line and ultimately proceeded north. The remaining Muslims who were members of the column were essentially stuck behind this interdiction line, and they surrendered ultimately to the VRS by the thousands.
Koliko ih je već izašlo?
Pa izašlo je oko 3 do 4.
To se sve predalo vama ovdje?
Da.
A kad kažemo toliko brojku, ljudi obično u Beogradu kažu preterana brojka.
Pa, preterana, ja šta je.
Ali toliko ih, ja?
Da. Toliko, toliko.
Evo ja dobro, vidite, imeno dobro.
Ne znam nije iz neke pustinje.
A koliko ste tamo proveli vreme?
Proveli smo dva dana i dvije noći.
Skroz opkureni još, gdje su vam puške?
Nisam nima puške, jedin sam, ja sam civil.
Civil?
Dobro.
Ste mnogo uplašili?
Kako se neš uplašiti?
Ajde, bolo, ne boj se. Šta se bojiš?
Ajde, bolo, ajde. Ajde, slobano.
E, čuje li se i to? Alo, alo, novna!
Ovo, evo istigo.
Is that you in this still image?
Yes.
Yes, that's me.
That's you at the time of your surrender, is that correct?
Yes.
Yes.
Now, Mr. Krstić, you described in part of your answer that you surrendered because you could hear Bosnian Serbs calling you down to surrender. Is that correct?
Not only because we heard them calling out to us to surrender, but also because we saw Amprofor there, because we thought that they couldn't simply kill us in the presence of Amprofor.
Krstić, a 17-year-old boy, managed to sneak into one of the buses that stopped by a meadow in Sandici, thus escaping the fate of the other men who had surrendered.
Then I decided to board the bus and then see what happened. So I threw away the jerry cans and I entered the bus. Meanwhile, the driver was talking to the Serb soldiers who were standing nearby. I got on the bus and I hid amongst the women who covered me with some bags. So when the driver came back, he started the engine, he didn't notice me, and he set off.
The others were transported to different locations in buses and trucks. From there, according to the prosecutor and his witnesses, they were taken to the place of execution.
You see the man in the blue shirt in the middle of that image, and he's flanked by two Bosnian Serb soldiers. Can you tell us his name?
Zove se Ramo.
Ramo is his name.
Did Ramo survive?
Yeah. Ne.
No.
Now, do you see the man in a camouflage T-shirt directly in front of you?
Da, vidim.
Could you tell the judges what happened to that man?
They ordered him to take off his T-shirt and they took him to the cornfield. And he also did not survive.
Were there a number of other individuals you can identify by name who did not survive?
Da.
Could you please identify those individuals who you saw alive on the meadow who did not survive?
I know my neighbors, Husic Mehmed, Husic Mehmed Alia, Husic Safet, and another man called Krstić Sead.
You know an individual named Sajdin Husic?
Yes, that is my father, who also did not survive.
Most, but not all, of the mass execution sites are located in the Zvornik area. Those sites include the Branjevo military farm, Pilica, the dam, Orahovac, and you can see that these sites are located far away from the enclave in Srebrenica. Now, not all of the mass execution sites were located so far away. And you'll be hearing evidence about a mass execution that took place at the Kravitsa warehouse, very close to the enclave and very close to the town of Bratnats, where the meetings with General Mladic and General Krstić occurred. You'll be hearing about a mass execution site that occurred in the Surska Valley. But the bulk, the majority of the mass executions took place far to the north.
Tada su nas postrojili u red i počeli su da pucaju rafalno sa desne moje strane. S tim ljudi su padali ovako prema levoj strani. Mene su ljudi oborili tako da mi je čovjek jedan zakrio ovaj dio lica, a pao je prije mene dok je moja ruka ostala njemu preko grudi. To je bio pucanj u stojećem stavu.
Were you hit?
Jeste li vi bili pogođeni?
Ne.
Is there anybody on top of you or?
Je li netko bio iznad vas ili blizu vas?
Jeste jedan od taj što je bio na meni, jer u mene je bilo na leđima jedna fleka krvi iz tog čovjeka koji je bio na meni, iz njega se cijedila krv. Posle te moje grupe jedan je zatražio dotuci me, taj je srpski vojnik.
The eight people who miraculously survived the Srebrenica executions testified at the trial of General Krstić. Among them was the 17-year-old boy from the group that surrendered to the Serbian forces on the 13th of July by a meadow near the village of Sandici. After the surrender, they were taken to the school in Petkovci by truck and then to the dam nearby. When they got there, they were ordered to get off the trucks in groups of five.
Neki su vikali, dajte nam vode, pa nas onda ubijte. I stvarno mi je bilo žao umrijeti žedan. I zavlačio sam se među ljude dok sam mogao, kao i svi ostali. Možda još koju sekundu da živim. I kada je stvarno došao red na mene, ja sam iskočio sa ostalim, mislim da je 4 čovjeka. Kada sam prišao malo bliže, dakle, s desne strane kamiona, vidio sam vrste ubijanih ljudi, kao da su redani jedna vrsta, pa druga, pa treća. Nisam mogao vidjeti krajeve, ali sam mogao naslutiti u mraku. Pomislio sam da ću brzo umrijeti, neću se patiti. I mislio sam da moja mama neće nikad znati gdje sam. Kada smo došli na mjesto, neko je rekao lezite. I onako kako smo pošli da ne da legnemo, nego da padamo naprijed. Dakle, leđima smo im bili okrenuti. Počela je pucnjava. Ja se nisam bacio, nego sam pošao da padnem i kasnije ne znam šta se je desilo. Nisam mislio da se bacim, da ostanem živ, to uopšte nisam nikad ni pomislio. Mislio sam da sam završio. Sljedeća je vrsta vjerovatno izvedena iza mene i kada je zapucano, onda sam osjetio jaku bol u nozi, nisam smio da vrisnem, ali sam se ustegao. U jednom trenutku, kada sam ležao, dakle nisam se derao, nisam vikao, vojnička čizma, u stvari ne znam da li je vojnička čizma, ali noga je stala ispred moga lica. I ja sam gledao, nisam zatvarao oči. Čovjek je prešao preko mene, dakle vojnik, i opucao je u glavu čovjeka pored mene, koji je stenjao. Ja sam zatvorio oči i tada me pogodilo u desnu ruku, u rame. Ne znam šta me je pogodilo, da li raspliskavajuća munica, ali zaista ne znam. Ili su kamenice, ali ne vjerujem da su kamenice. Jer imam i dalje metalnih stranih tijela u desnoj ruci. Imam i u grudnom košu, isto u stopalu. I onda sam, kada me pogodilo u rame, onda sam rekao, aj majko, pa sad sam izranjavan, zašto ne umrem?
When the soldiers left, the wounded boy found another survivor and together they escaped from the execution site. On a photograph of the dam, he charted the route they took to escape and marked the area which was, as they were able to see in the morning from the hill where they hid, covered in dead bodies.
Mislim, iz svega ovoga što sam pričao i što sam vidio, mogao sam zaključiti da je to bilo vrlo, vrlo organizovano. Sistematsko ubijanje. I mislim da organizatori toga ne zaslužuju da budu na slobodi. A ako bi imao pravo i hrabrosti u ime svih nevinih, u ime svih žrtava, ja bi oprostio onim neposrednim egzekutorima, jer oni su zavedeni.
Poštovani sude, ja sam to morao da radim. Da sam odbio to da radim, ubili bi i mene sa tim ljudima. Kad sam odbijao da radim, rekli su mi, ako ti je žao, stani ti s njima da ih tebe ubijem. Meni nije bilo žao mene. Meni je bilo žao moje porodice i moje supruge i moga sina, koji je tada imao 9 mjeseci i koji bi on isto ubili. Da sam odbio to da radim. To je sve što želim biti.
Dražen Edemović is the first accused person to plead guilty before the tribunal. Because he pleaded guilty, showed remorse, and cooperated fully with the office of the prosecutor, he was sentenced to a 5-year prison sentence. He's been released from prison and entered the Tribunal Witness Protection Program. At General Krstić's trial, he testified under his own name, but with facial distortion. On the 16th of July 1995, Ademović and seven other members of the VRS 10th Sabotage Detachment were brought to a farm in Branjevo, escorted by a lieutenant colonel and two military police officers from the Drina Corps. The lieutenant colonel and the military police soon left, and the group commander, Brano Gojković, told Ademović and the others what their task for the day would be, to shoot the people who would be brought in on buses.
Kad je došao prvi autobus, ja znam za sve, ne znam za ostale, ne mogu da kažeš ko je što taj ostali govori. Rekao da ne želim to da radim, da ne mogu to da radim, da to nije naš zadatak, naše jedinice. Brano mi je tad rekao, ako nećeš da radiš, stani s njima ili daj ti njima svoju pušku pa da vidiš hoće li oni u tebe pucati. Tad je Brano rekao da mi stanemo u stroj, postavimo u stroj, ispred nas je naređeno ljudima da se nama okrenu leđima. Kad su te ti ljudi okrenuli leđima, mi smo pucali u te ljude. Naređeno da se puca u ljude.
Nakon što je streljana ova prva grupa od 10 zatočenika, šta se zatim desilo?
Dovedena je druga grupa i ona je postrojena odmah iza tih prvih ljudi koji su ubijeni, nazad, išlo se nazad prema garaži.
I onda pretpostavljam da je dovedena još jedna grupa na streljani i da su i oni streljani. Dakle, to se ponavljalo tokom čitavog dana.
Da.
U koliko sati su počela pogubljenja ujutro 16. jula?
Ja mislim oko 10 časova.
U koliko sati je to sve završilo toga istog dana?
3-4 posle podne.
Koliko ljudi, po vašoj procjeni, gospodine Ardemoviću, je pogubljeno na farmi Branjevo 16. jula?
Ja mislim oko 1000-1200.
Je li jedan pripadnik vaše jedinice, gospodine Ardemoviću, da li se on vama hvalio koliko je ljudi ubio na vojnoj farmi Branjevo?
Da, to je Savanović Stanko pod brojem 3. Rekao je da je ubio između 200 i 300 ljudi. Da je on brojao.
Koja je bila starosna dob ljudi koji su pobijeni na vojnoj farmi Branjevo?
Sam ja procijenio između 17 i 60 i 70 godina.
How are these people dressed? Kako su ti ljudi bili odjeveni?
Svi su bili u civilnoj odjeći, osim jednoga, imao je maskirne hlače.
On the aerial photograph of the farm in Branjevo, dated the 17th of July 1995, a day after the massacre, Ademović pointed out the pile of unburied bodies of the victims. He described how a group of soldiers came to help them out from Bratunac. The victims were treated brutally. The lieutenant colonel and two military police from the Drina Corps, who had returned to the farm in the meantime, attended the execution of the captives from the last bus.
Nedugo zatim je došao taj potpukovnik Brano, Aleksandar Cvjetković, Savanović, i odmah je rekao treba da se ide u obližni dom u tom mjestu, da tamo ima 500 muslimana iz Srebrenice koji hoće da provale vrata iz doma. Nas četvorca smo rekli da to nećemo da uradimo, da nam je dosta, da mi nismo ničije mašine za ubivanje ljudi. Brano je rekao, pa zašto? Pa mi smo rekli da nećemo više, da je dosta, dosta. I tada je potpuno se okrenuo i otišao je tamo do tih ljudi iz Bratunca. I oni su, ne znam, posle koliko minut, dva, pet, odmah otišli. Sjeli u vozila i otišli. Dok mi još smo bili tu na farmi, smo pakirali to svoje oružje i sve to što je bilo, već smo čuli pucnjavu u tom pravcu mjesta Pilica.
About 500 captured men were killed on the 16th of July 1995 in the community center in Pilica. When the investigators from the office of the prosecutor arrived there 14 months later, they found traces of the explosions and rifle fire, bullets and casings, documents, and, as the leader of the Srebrenica investigation team testified, numerous human remains on the floor, walls and ceiling.
Peel, skin,
koža, krv, dlake, dakle svi oni uzorci koje su pokupili veštaci. Ovo je karta mesta zločina predmeta Srebrenica i na ovoj karti se vidi i reljef koji je dosta precizan.
Jean-René Ruez is the leader of the Office of the Prosecutor team in charge of the investigation into what happened at Srebrenica. The investigation began on the 20th July 1995 and is still ongoing. Forensic and crime experts from 24 countries have been involved in the investigation. Primary mass graves were located on the actual execution sites or in their immediate vicinity. Ruez pointed out the five major ones on a map depicting the crime scenes. The Branjevo farm, Kozluk, the Betkovtsi dam, Klogova, where the victims from the Kravitsa warehouse were buried, and Orahovats. Yet, as the world began to uncover the scale of the Srebrenica crimes in the autumn of 1995, the graves were exhumed and the remains of the victims were moved to remote and clandestine locations called secondary grave sites. Ruez pointed out the sites of so-called secondary mass graves on the map. There were three clusters of mass graves in the north, first one on the road to Hodžići, the second one in the area of a place called Lipje, and the third group of secondary sites is located south of the former enclave Srebrenica in the area of Zelenijada. Ruez admitted that the office of the prosecutor would have been unable to discover the location of the secondary grave sites without the aerial photographs given to the tribunal by the American government. Dozens of photographs were brought before the court. It was easy to spot the changes in the terrain configuration before and after the exhumation. Photographs of the same areas shown side by side, taken on several occasions, depict first untouched soil, then freshly dug soil, pits that had been dug out and then covered in soil. Following the trail of the photographs, the investigators found more than 30 secondary mass graves.
Part of a process is to scoop the surface. At one point you will see that there is a difference of color in the soil. And here Richard Wright just marked this, and now he's putting flags on this perimeter. And here you can see, on the left and on the right, there is already a difference. And they are currently narrowing down the size of it. And here the first human remains start to appear. And since it is a secondary site, there are very few complete bodies in it. Due to the way the initial burial was conducted, using heavy equipment, then the unburial, using again heavy equipment, then the transportation in trucks, the dumping from the trucks, the refilling of the hole with heavy equipment, all this destroys the bodies, and you end up at the end only with kind of mixture of body parts.
The remains of over 2,000 victims from Srebrenica have been found in the mass graves exhumed to date. It's estimated that the remains of around 2,500 more victims lie in the grave sites that have been located and examined but are yet to be exhumed. Forensic medicine experts Jim Clark and Christopher Lawrence presented to the court the results of the post-mortem examinations carried out on the remains of the Srebrenica victims. In most cases, they stated that the cause of death was a gunshot wound, often to the back of the head or the spine.
Number 61, he was found with a ligature partly around his wrists. He had 3 gunshot injuries. One to the back of the head and 2 to the legs.
Investigator Dean Menning, archaeologist Richard Wright and forensic anthropologist William Haglund testified about other objects found in the mass graves.
Clearly around the arm and wrists of this individual is a ligature made of twine or string.
You can see that the arms are crossed over in the area of the wrist, and here is a cloth ligature, again knotted sleeve. This is one of his hands and this is another of his hands. Binding and digging into the flesh is a wire ligature. It has a metal tag identifying it. It also has what I believe to be hair and human tissue adhering to it. And as you can see, it's the blindfold that you see on that image.
So it's the blindfold depicted in the large image on the easel.
That's the blindfold removed from that body.
270 blindfolds were found on the bodies of the Srebrenica victims exhumed so far.
And being shot on the spot excludes being shot in a fight. The arrangement you mentioned...
No, I think being shot on the spot does not exclude people being shot in a fight. However, at Kozluk, 42% of the 280 individuals had their hands tied behind their back, and in my opinion, that does exclude people being shot in a fight.
The task of reconstructing the role played by the accused general Radislav Krstic in the deportations of women and children and the mass executions of men was entrusted to Richard Butler, military intelligence analyst with the Office of the Prosecutor. It was his task to analyse the legal regulations of the VRS, its command structure and the powers and responsibilities of corps commander. Butler did this by cross-referencing the data from various sources, documents, orders and combat reports of the VRS, transcripts of intercepted radio communications between various headquarters and units of the Drina Corps, aerial photographs, videotapes, witness testimonies and information from the media and other open sources. Among the 30,000-odd documents seized by the investigators in the course of their searches of the VRS headquarters were a number of work orders authorising the use of trucks, buses, excavators, bulldozers and other construction machinery, and orderly records about the amounts of diesel and petrol issued. By establishing a link between the work orders and combat orders and reports, radio intercepts, aerial photographs and survivors' testimonies, Butler was able to reconstruct in detail which units of the Drina Corps participated in the transportation of the captives from the place where they had surrendered to the execution sites and in the digging of mass graves. As it turned out, VRS officers were quite careless or overly self-confident. In the course of the Srebrenica operation, they communicated using open or insufficiently protected communication lines. The court was presented with dozens of transcripts of radio and telephone intercepts. Members of the BH Army and Security Service surveillance teams testified to their authenticity. General Krstić has been identified as a participant in several conversations, including the one with Colonel Leo Bubiara, Chief of Security Service of the VRS General Staff. In the conversation, Colonel Biara begs Kurler to send him 15 to 30 men, since he has another 3,500 packages to distribute, and Kurler promises he would see what he can do. According to the prosecution, there is no doubt that the packages are the captured men and that to distribute is to execute. Richard Dannett, a British general who served for several years in Bosnia as a commander in the UN Peace Force and NATO, reached similar conclusions regarding the role played by General Krstić. Analyzing General Krstić's military career and the orders he issued as the chief of staff of the Drina Corps, the general said that the accused was a competent and experienced staff officer. General Danet analyzed the planning and execution of Operation Krivaya 95, the codename for the attack on Srebrenica. According to his analysis, four operations were conducted in parallel: the capturing of men and deportations of women and children, the cutting off and surrounding of the fighters of the 28th Division and civilians trying to reach Tuzla, the action to take Zhepa, and finally what he termed the dark operation, the execution of the captured men. The judge asked him whether the dark operation could have been carried out without General Krstić's knowledge.
No, I have to say that, because I go back, Your Honour, to one of my earlier points of yesterday, that command is a personal thing, and the commander does take personal responsibility for all that goes on in his zone of responsibility.
Odgovornost snosi komandant glavnog štaba Vojske Republike Srpske, general Mladić, i starešine koje je on lično angažovao u komandovanju i upravljanju situacijom na tome prostoru. Pukovnik Beara Ljubo, načelnik uprave bezbednosti glavnog štaba, koji je počinjen generalu Tolmiru, pomoćniku komandanta glavnog štaba za obavještajno-bezbednosne poslove. Major Pećanac, koji je bio u upravi bezbednosti, počinjen pukovniku Beari Ljubu. A inače, major Pećanac je bio šef obezbeđenja komandanta glavnog štaba generala Mladića. Zatim, poručnik Pelemiš Mišo, na dužnosti komandanta 10. diverzantskog odreda, počinjen generalu Mladiću, jer je to jedinica glavnog štaba. Major Malinović, komandant bataljona vojne policije u Novoj Kasarni. Potpukovnik Popović Vujadin, načelnik bezbednosti Drinskog korpusa, koga je lično angažovao general Mladić. Nabrojana grupa starešina od početka rata na prostorima bivše Jugoslavije prati generala Mladića još iz Knina i on je imao u njih neizmjerno poverenje. Oni su naprosto bili nedodirljivi za bilo koga kada bi pokušao da preduzme neke mjere protiv njih. Dakle, nabrojene starešine su glavni naredbodavci i egzekutori svega što se desilo u vremenu od 11. do 20. septembra.
This is the statement General Krstić gave to investigator Jean-René Ruiz in February 2000, a month before his trial begun. The prosecution first showed the tape of the interview with the accused in closed session. The tape was shown in open session a week later in order to protect the persons who might have been endangered by what Krstić had said.
Svi zarobljeni su predati generalu Mladiću. Njihovo prikupljanje je izvršeno na stadionu u Novoj Kasarni, na fudbalskom igralištu. Nakon toga došlo do saznanja da su oni prevoženi prema Bratuncu, nekim objektima u Kravici, a u najvećem broju u Bratuncu. Dalje postupanje sa njima je bilo isto kao sa onim koji su skidani sa autobusa u Potočare. Njihova bezbednosna obrada i ono što se sve kasnije desilo sa njim.
What happened in Vilbe?
Šta se dogodilo u ovim selima, na primjer u selu Laze?
Znači, na osnovu podataka koji sam mogao doći, došlo do smrtnuća tih ljudi.
Svečano izjavljujem da ću govoriti istinu, cijelu istinu i ništa osim istine.
General, you have...
Generale, vi ste rekli gospodinu Ruezu da je general Mladić taj koji je ubio hiljade muslimana, a sad nam kažete da ste se plašili da objelodanite te zločine. Zar se vi niste plašili generala Mladića na bilo koji način?
Sam rekao da je general Mladić odgovoran za zločine. Može se reći da se plašio i njega i njegove službe bezbednosti.
Ja moram vama ovdje da priznam i vama i pred ovim srpskom vijećem, ja ni u ludilu nisam smio preduzeti neke druge mjere. Jednostavno o tome se nije smjelo pričati, a kamoli preduzeti neke mjere protiv nekoga starešine, bez obzira na moja saznanja da je on, možda i neki drugi, da su počinili ratni zločin.
Testifying at the beginning of the defense case, General Krstić claimed that Operation Krivaya 95 was forced by the constant commando and terrorist activities of the 28th Division stationed in the enclave. The activities were stepped up in particular in the spring of that year, in the course of the BH Army offensive, with the objective of lifting the siege of Sarajevo. According to Krstić, the primary goal of Krivaya 95 was to reduce the safe area to the actual town of Srebrenica, and to cut it off from Zepa. When that objective was achieved, Krstić claims General Mladić ordered the operation to continue till the final elimination of the enclaves.
Nakon što su komandanti jedinica podnijeli izvještaj da su izvršili zadatak, onda general Mladić poziva sve komandante redom. Niste izvršili zadatak. Nastavite napad pravac Srebrenica, ući u Srebrenicu. Doslovce je rekao, sada ja komandujem snagama angažovanim u operaciji. Poznato je, ko je poznavao generala Mladića, u ranijim slučajima i događajima, da je on veoma često preuzimao na pojedinim dijelovima fronta diljem Bosne i Hercegovine preuzima ulogu čak komandanta bataljona, pa i komandira četnika. Nama je rekao, vidite kako se komanda.
After Mladić took over command of the Srebrenica operation, General Krstić was, as he stated, reduced to the status of a mere observer. Then Mladić ordered him to command the attack of the Drina Corps on the Zepa enclave. Krstić claims that he then left the Srebrenica area. However, the prosecution showed tapes which, as they claim, prove that both Radovan Karadzic and Ratko Mladić considered General Krstić to be much more than a mere observer in Srebrenica.
Od Mladića legendu, jer mi znamo da naš narod želi legende. Međutim, propustili smo da malo iznesemo i uspjehe pojedinih komandanata korpusa. Recimo sada Krstić, koji je isplanirao i predavnom i ja sam odobrio taj zadatak za Srebrenicu, koji je to izvanredno uradio, naravno pomaže glavni štab i Mladić i svi drugi, ali treba znati da je taj Krstić veliki vojskovođa.
Ja ovaj intervju i stav predsjednika Karadžića uopšte ne bi komentarisao. Jo, nema nikakvog osnova da ovako nešto kaže.
At a parade in Vlasenica in December 1995, General Radislav Krstić and Colonel Leo Bubiara accompanied Mladić. Without stating his name, Mladić praised in his speech the Drina Corps commander. He said the commander, although being seriously wounded himself, contributed greatly to the victory over the Muslim gladiators in Srebrenica and Zepa. Krstić, who lost a leg in January 1995 in a mine explosion, denies that the compliments were addressed to him.
Dakle, ja ne sporim da je ovo general Mladić rekao, ali nije bio jasan o kome se to radi. I ne vidim razloga zašto bi on na ovakvom jednom skupu isticao mene, koji sam tek primio i tada tek skoro bio primljen dužnost načelnika štaba i dužnost, a posle toga dužnost komandanta.
General Krstić, for the time period between July 11th and November 1st, 1995, did you order the summary executions of captured Muslims?
Nikada to nisam.
At the same time period, did you ever order anyone to take no prisoners?
It became clear why the prosecution asked that question the next day when a tape recording of an intercepted telephone conversation was played. The conversation was dated the 2nd of August 1995. The prosecution claims that the participants were General Krstić and Major Dragan Obrenović, Chief of Staff of the VRS Svornik Brigade.
General Krstić, did you, on August 2nd, 1995, tell Major Obrenović to kill the people he'd captured that day?
Ne, gospodine Meklotski, ovo je 100% montaža. Prvo, toga dana nisam uopšte razgovarao sa Obrenovićem. Drugo, ja ne mogu da poznam ni onoga drugoga učesnika u razgovoru, a pogotovo sebe. Ponavljam, ovo je 100% montaža. Nikada ne bi tako naredio ni telefonom, ni fizički da je bio prisutan kod mene. Nikada.
The prosecution had possession of the tape in the course of their case, but they left it until the end of Krstić's testimony to show that the accused had not spoken the truth and to challenge the credibility of his version of the events in Srebrenica. The tactics backfired. The judges ruled that the tape of the intercept could not be admitted into evidence. A total of 12 witnesses testified for General Krstić, Radovan Radinovic, a retired VJ general and lecturer at the highest military schools, played the main role in his defence. As the defence military expert, Radinovic filed a report in which he analysed in detail all the stages of the Srebrenica operation and the role of General Krstić therein. In his lengthy testimony, Radinovic challenged the prosecution claims about the planned, organised and coordinated character of the massacre in Srebrenica, claiming that most of the victims had been killed in the fighting. Just like General Krstić, Radinovic stated that the attack on Srebrenica was forced by the commando and terrorist activities of the 28th Division, and that the original goal of the operation was to reduce the area of the safe havens, and not to eliminate them completely. As he said, that was out of the question because of the balance of power.
Ako se računice svede na snage koje su direktno sudarene i na jednoj i na drugoj strani, u Srebrnici, u operaciji Kriva 95, onda moja računica iznose da je odnos snaga 2,8 naprama 1 u korist snaga 28. divizije. I 28. divizija je sasvim sigurno mogla da brani Srebrnicu dugo, toliko dugo, to ponavljam, toliko dugo, dokle bi se nesporno i neizostavno umešale međunarodne snage, odnosno sistem Ujedinjenih nacija koji bi sprečio dalju eskalaciju sukoba. Onda doista i vrhovna komanda, odnosno sistem komandovanja u Srebrenici od strane muslimana nosi veliku odgovornost.
Kad govorimo o greškama političkog i vojnog vođstva Republike Bosne i Hercegovine, mislim prije svega
da je trebalo planirati operaciju oslobađanja Podrinja, pa tek onda deblokade Sarajeva. A ako se krenulo deblokadu Sarajeva, onda su se morale preduzeti mjere da se ojača odbrana Srebrenice i Žrpe, što naravno nije urađeno.
In order to establish the actual strength and role of the 28th Division, the prosecution and defence having made assessments that were vastly different, the judges summoned two former BH Army Chiefs of Staff to testify as court witnesses. Both stated that the 28th Division was a division on paper only because it was lacking basic military equipment and weapons, but that assistance could have been provided to Srebrenica.
Ja sam kasnije saznao da su komanda drugog korpusa i generalštab znali kad je počela operacija na Srebrenicu, ali iz niza svjedočenja ljudi koji su bili u Srebrenici, kako iz vojnih, tako i političkih struktura, se jasno vidi da su oni tražili pomoć i od komande drugog korpusa i od komande generalštaba i od predsjednika Izetbegovića, ali da je nisu dobili. Na vaše pitanje da li su imali snage i sredstava da pomognu Srebrenici, ja mislim da jesu. Prije svega, trebalo je prije sarajevske operacije osigurati Srebrenicu i Žepu i zato se u to vrijeme imalo i dovoljno ljudi i dovoljno sredstava. A ne krenuti sarajevsku operaciju i ostaviti Srebrenicu i Žepu na milost, ne milost.
But why kill all these people as opposed to putting them in prisons and exchanging them later and even putting them in camps, as we well know, we have lots of experience with detention camps, but the immediate executions, which were, at least so far as we know, a bit unusual.
Evo danas, na današnji dan, u Dolne Drine ima više od 60 šatorskih bošnjačkih naselja koji žele se vratiti svojim kućama. Oni koji su pogubljeni, oni se nikad neće moći vratiti. A strateški cilj je bio očistiti Dolinu Drine i ukloniti je kao vjekovnu granicu između dvije srpske države.
Srebrenica je bila završni čin jednog ukupnog scenarija kada je u pitanju Podrinje i zadatak Drinskog korpusa. Jer krajnji cilj je bio da nema nesrpskog stanovništva u pojasu rijeke Drine. Nesrpsko stanovništvo mora nestati odatle kako bi Drina prestala biti granica između srpskih država.
The defense military expert, however, pointed to another possible scenario, one which implicated the French intelligence service. At the end of the cross-examination, the prosecution read out a part of a report that Radinovich had filed with the court. In that report, the defense military expert quotes the statement of the former Yugoslav Minister of Information, given when the alleged sabotage group codenamed Spider was arrested.
That group consisted of paid Croats, Slovenes, Muslims and Serbs. French intelligence service organized, equipped and trained the group to perform the massacre of Muslim civilians with the aim of attributing that crime to the Serbs and declaring the Serb military and political strategy to be criminal and Republika Srpska as a political result of a world crime. After that scenario, all violence against the Serbs became legitimate. General, do you really believe that the French intelligence services use mercenaries to kill thousands of Muslims in the Zvornik?
Gospodine, ja kao odgovoran čovjek koji se bavio jednom teškom temom, nisam smatrao, zapravo smatrao sam da nemam prava da ignorišem činjenicu da je pred domaćom i svjetskom javnošću ovlašteni ministar jedne države, makar koja bila i makar kakav to bio ministar, iznosi činjenice o učešću jedne grupe
kao direktne... General, you are the expert. Do you, Do you believe that Goran Matic was telling the truth? It's in your report, General. You refer to this. Was Goran Matic telling the truth when he said the French intelligence services were responsible for killing thousands of people in July of 1995?
Ja niti znam, niti ne znam da li je govorio istinu. Ali ja kao čovjek koji se tom temom bavio, nisam smeo da ignorišem tu činjenicu da je taj ministar u to vreme govorio o tome.
General, thank you very much indeed. Mr. President, thank you. I have finished my cross-examination.
Dobro, dobro, znam ja da može neki da on za mnom polako.
As he entered Srebrenica in triumph on the 11th of July 1995, General Ratko Mladic was accompanied by Generals Milenko Zivanovic, nicknamed Žile, and Radislav Krstic, nicknamed Krle. The former was at the time the commander and the latter the chief of staff of the VRS Drina Corps. The main point at issue in the course of the 15-month-long trial was the exact time when Krstić replaced Zivanovic as the Corps' commander. The prosecution claimed that the handover had been done no later than on the 13th of July, whereas the defence argued that it had been done on the 20th of July at the earliest, in other words, after the most serious crimes in Srebrenica had already been committed. Neither of the parties, however, had documents to corroborate their claims. As the trial drew to a close, the prosecution managed to find the missing link in the chain of evidence of General Krstić's guilt. This crucial piece of evidence was obtained thanks to General Milenko Zivanovic. A member of the investigation team met with him twice in April 2001 in Valjevo.
According to General Zivanovic, he gave up his duty on the 11th of July 1995 in Bratnac. On the 12th, he was told that the new commander was Krstić. And then on the 13th of July 1995, General Mladic and General Krstić came to General Zivanovic's corps headquarters in Vlasnica. And the command was lined up so Zivanovic could say goodbye to them.
During the second meeting, General Zivanovic gave the OTP investigator a document dated the 13th of July 1995, informing the subordinate units of the Drina Corps that General Krstić took over as the Corps' commander on that date. On the same day and at the same time, the 13th of July 1995, 2000 hours, the new commander issued his first order for a search of the terrain to be conducted. In the course of the search, thousands of men trying to make their way to Tuzla were captured. Krstić signed the order as commander. The document had already been admitted into evidence as a prosecution exhibit, but now it was shown again, side by side with the notification of the handover, in order to prove that the documents were drafted and dispatched at the same time. In an attempt to challenge the probative value of the documents, the defence again called its military expert, General Radovan Radinovic.
Gospodine generale, da li ovaj dokument, dokazni predmet tužilaštva 905, može biti relevantan u vezi određivanja datuma kada je general Krstić preuzeo komandu nad Drinskim korpusom? Kako je vaše mišljenje o tome?
Moje mišljenje je da ovaj dokument ne može biti relevantan za utvrđivanje datuma kada je general Krstić preuzeo dužnost komandanta Drinskog korpusa. Dokument od 13. jula nije zapisnik o primopredaji dužnosti koji bi bio jedino relevantan da utvrdi datum kada je izvršena primopredaja dužnosti između generala Krstića i generala Živanovića. Dokument je samo informacija, odnosno obaveštenje o tome da je ta primopredaja navodno izvršena. Dakle, to je potpuno neoficijalan i neobavezujući dokument.
The judges, however, disagreed with the defense expert. They concluded that the document was relevant and admitted it into evidence.
In this case, General Krstić has had the benefit of a trial with the full panoply of rights enshrined in international law accorded to him. A triumph of the rule of law and of civilization over the atavistic impulses that surely motivated he and his collaborators to slaughter thousands of helpless victims, to deport 35,000 people from their lands and the lands of their ancestors, and to deprive them all of their fundamental human rights. The defendant has had the benefit of a trial. His victims did not. The aggravating factors are overwhelming. I've touched on them throughout my closing submissions. Meditation and planning that went into them. The suffering of the victims, both the dead and the living. The destruction of the community from eastern Bosnia and the Srebrenica area. The immediate and long-term psychological and material impact that these crimes have had and continue to have on the surviving victims. The accused's repeated false testimony under oath and his complete lack of remorse for the crimes that he committed. It is with that in mind, Your Honors, that I request this honorable trial chamber to find the defendant Radislav Krstic guilty on all available counts in the indictment, and that you sentence him to life sentences for each of the counts in the indictment for which he is found guilty. And further, that these life sentences be consecutive to one another.
Ubistva u Srebrenici su bila užasna, ali nisu genocid, kako je definisano Konvencijom o genocidu I članom 4 statuta ovog tribunala. Jednostavno, ne postoji dokaz na kome bi ovo sudsko veće moglo da zaključi van svake sumnje da su ubistva izvršena sa namerom da unište u celini I delimično bosanske muslimane kao grupu. Da je zaista postojala namera da se unište bosanski muslimani kao grupa, tužilac bi trebalo da bude sposoban da lako odgovori na sledeće pitanje. Zašto žene I deca nisu ubijeni u potočarima, kao što je učinjeno sa jevrejskim, jermenskim I tuci ženama I decom? Zašto nisu ubijeni bosanski muslimani u Žepi? Zašto nisu bili ubijeni ranjenici? Zašto su ubistva u Srebrenici izolovan I jedinstven slučaj u toku četvorogodišnjeg rata u Bosni? Rečeno je da je ovo suđenje traganje za istinu. Istina o tome šta se desilo u Srebrenici u julu 1995. je zaista izašla na videlo u toku 15 meseci ovog suđenja. Istina je da je mnogo bosanskih muslimana ubijeno u Srebrenici. Istina je da su ova ubistva neopravdana, nezakonita I nemoralna. Ali je takođe istina da ova ubistva nisu učinjena sa namerom da se unište bosanski muslimani kao grupa u celini ili delimično. Ako sudsko veće sledi činjenice, ako sudsko veće sledi zakon, ako sudsko veće sledi istoriju, odlučit će da general Krstić nije kriv za genocid ili saučesništvo u genocidu.
The International Criminal Tribunal for the Former Yugoslavia is now session. L'audience tribunal pénal international pour l'ex-Yougoslavie et Vecht. Please be seated.
Bonjour, General Krstic.
Good afternoon, General Krstic. May justice be done,
ou le monde périra,
lest the world perish,
disait Hegel.
Said Hegel. The trial chamber is doing its duty in meeting out justice today, and in this way hopes to have contributed to creating a better world. General Krstić, the trial chamber does not dispute that you are a professional soldier who loves his work. Someone else probably decided to order the execution of all the men of fighting age. The chamber is convinced of that. However, nonetheless, you are still guilty, General Krstić. You are guilty of having knowingly participated in the organized, forced transfer of the women, children, and old people in Srebrenica at the time of the attack on the 6th of July 1995 against the United Nations safe area. You are guilty of the murder of thousands of Bosnian Muslims between 10 and 19 July 1995. You are guilty of the incredible suffering of the Bosnian Muslims, whether these be the ones in Potocari or survivors of the executions. You are guilty of the persecution suffered by the Bosnian Muslims of Srebrenica. Knowing that the women, children, and old people of Srebrenica had been transferred, you are guilty of having agreed to the plan to conduct mass executions of all the men of fighting age. You are therefore guilty of genocide, General Krstić. And this is why, today, this trial chamber convicts you and sentences you to 46 years in prison. The court stands adjourned.